Hello everyone, we are a group of B.Tech students from Chemical Engineering Department of IIT Bombay, and this is a project for the course heat transfer. So as the name suggests, our project is on compact cold storage. We came across a social issue of extensive amount of waste of fresh fruits and vegetables due to lack of cold storage infrastructure in our nation. We decided to look for a solution to this issue, and this is a modest attempt for this. Indian farmers over the years have faced the wrath of the can be seasonal changes for country. Most of them are in a rural setting with not much capital to spend, and so availing facilities like cold storages with energy efficiency becomes an issue. Electricity is also not an easily available resource. We move towards solving this issue by improvising upon the existing modes of storage and making more energy and capital intensive along with being of utility. Farmers generally are not able to get adequate facilities to store their goods before they reach the market. The reports from Financial Express show that per year 15% of all the fresh fruits and vegetables get spoiled due to lack of proper cold storage facilities, and this has been the cause of farmer distress and suicides. So, we decided to work on this issue, and we took our inspiration from an ice cream cart study. So the most prevalent problem is the space needed, and hence we took inspiration from this eutectic system of ice cream cold storages. The study started with the cold storage where they tried maintaining the temperature of the ice cream using eutectic cooling pads which absorb heat from the ice cream. However, there was a direct influx of heat from outside which made the design flawed. So they switched the design where the eutectic entirely covered all the walls, and hence any heat from outside was also absorbed by it. This helped keeping the ice cream at a constant temperature much better than the previous design, and hence the inspiration.
So, control volume and schematic diagram. This diagram shows the total system in a cold storage room, assuming a single crate for fruit storage. This diagram shows that the wall has layers of clay, cement, brick and eutectic along the air gaps to account for contact resistance between these materials. The layers facing the atmosphere is at room temperature, and conduction happens through the various layers of the wall. Convection is possible with air gaps. However, since the air gaps are very thin, convection can be ignored and conduction is taken into account. Convection and radiation occur from the crate to the wall. The dynamic cooling model has three fruits modeled as cylinders in a 2D sense, having colder fluid flow over them, taking away their constant heat flux. Post-convection occurs in the dynamic model. It is considered as laminar flow. An appropriate Nusselt correlation for flow over a cylinder was chosen. This diagram is showing the conduction. This diagram is showing radiation, and this diagram is showing convection. For the dynamic system, this video shows the direction. Estimation of modes of heat transfer. For conduction, this is the formula. And the approximate value comes out to be 116 joules per meter square second. For convection, this is the formula, and the approximate value comes out to be 98.19 watt per meter square. For radiation, this is the formula, and the approximate value is 102.805 watt per meter square. So for heat flux, control volume can be viewed as the following, and heat flux follows the path which are shown by the direction of the arrows for both wall and dynamic cooler.
As we have discussed our control volume of the system, now we can frame our textbook problem. So there is a cold storage and enclosure with a single crate maintained at a temperature of 285 Kelvin. The inner walls of the room are maintained at a temperature of 263 Kelvin with the help of eutectic mixture. The room walls have three layers. The outermost is clay soil, the middle one is cement, and the third one, the innermost layer of bricks. The outermost wall is at a temperature of 303 Kelvin. Inside the room, there is a convective heat flow from the carrier to the room walls, and the thermal expansion coefficient for the same is 1 by 263. Also, the crate radiates heat to the walls, and the crates are assumed to be as a black body so that we can find the maximum loads. Now, we will find the time taken to melt the eutectic. Eventually, what is happening, all the heat transported is going to melt the eutectic. And the mass, latent heat capacity, the inner dimension of rooms, inner dimension of crate are given in the problem statement. Now, that was our part one of the problem statement. The part two is, as a comparison to the conventional cold storage design, we looked into an alternative crate design with fluid, which is water, at 283 Kelvin flowing into a channel of length 1 meter with 3 consecutive cylindrical cavities, each of diameter 10 cm, which can be taken as the diameter of fluid cap in the laminar flow, which has a velocity of 0.005. Hence, the forced convection is happening here. Each of the fluids emit constant heat flux having value of heat of respiration, that is 700. Now we will discuss the temperature profile for the outer wall. So as you can see, there is a linear variation in the temperature profile because we use 2D modeling here. Now next, the temperature profile for the dynamic system is as shown in this figure. Also, the dynamic system is at its steady state. Now we will see the video in which we will see how the temperature, how the profile varies with time. So here, as we might expect, the higher temperature is seen around the fluids and it lowers down subsequently until it again gains heat from the heat sources. So this is the temperature profile for our dynamic system. Now we will solve our heat transfer problem with the resistance model. So heat is coming from this direction, and all the resistances are shown in this figure. The clay, the air gap between clay and cement, air gap between cement and brick, and then brick. And eutectic air absorbs all the heat that is transmitted into it. So there are some assumptions made by us to solve this problem. The first one is steady state is considered. The second is the temperature of the external clay wall is assumed to be constant. Also, the air inside the room is assumed to be at 263 Kelvin. The carrier and the eutectic wall inside the room is assumed to be black body. Free convection is happening inside the room. These are some assumptions that we made. Now we will see the solvent methodology. So the heat transfer to the eutectic from outside and from the convection inside the room is given by this formula Q equal to this. And the total resistance for the same is this. Now we will find the time taken to melt the eutectic. So that will be given as delta T equal to ML by Q. From here we will find our delta T. Now what we did, we wrote a general MATLAB code for the time taken to melt the eutectic. We varies the thermal conductivities of brick, cement and clay, and then find the most optimum value. Now, to calculate the time taken to melt the eutectic, we wrote a general MATLAB code and try to vary the values of thermal conductivity of brick, cement, clay, and the moisture content of clay soil. And that what we found is that the combination of values corresponding to this serial number 2 gives us the most optimum combination. Most optimum combination is something that will give us the highest time to melt the eutectic.
Coming to the dynamic system. For the dynamic system, OpenFOAM has been used. OpenFOAM is a software which helps simulate different flow conditions. In this case, we have used OpenFOAM with its utilities like block mesh to create our mesh and ParaView to view the results. The solver used is Buoyant Simple Foam. Buoyant Simple Foam is a steady state solver, which is used for incompressible flows in heat and fluid transfer. The geometry which we defined was such that the inlet conditions have been as specified, and we had to find the outlet temperature profile in order to get an average temperature profile and hence the amount of heat which has entered the fluid, right? And as mentioned before, a constant heat flux is coming out from these cylinders. So the actual boundary conditions which were specified in open foam were that the inlet was at fixed values and the outlet was at zero gradient. The adiabatic top, bottom walls and the heated cylinders, all of them had no slip boundary conditions because we are considering laminar flow. Also, the gradient is specified like this in open foam according to the flux we've entered. Now, generally, for solving in open foam, we have to validate a case for which we already have data existing in some or the other paper. This is because we want to ensure that our solvers and our boundary conditions are completely correct according to what we are going to solve and the results of which do not already exist. So the validation case which we chose was a channel having a heated portion in its wall. And these are the results from the paper, and we generated the flow and got the streamlines at this. And as we can see, they are quite comparable. Now, in our present case, for the mesh which I had shown, we simulated the case, and on changing the different ranges of temperatures, we observed that the variation was around 0.001 Kelvin. And hence the power needed is calculated as shown here. The Reynolds number for a velocity of 0.005 came out to be in the laminar range, which is 408. The power required for the temperature difference of 0.0001 is calculated as follows: delta T into Cp of water, which was our fluid chosen, and m dot according to a rectangular channel as shown in the geometry. And this was the value it calculated out to come. And also the change in kinetic energy has been calculated here. So basically the entire energy which we required was of the order of 10 to the power minus 5 watts for a set of three fluids. Now, as we can see that this energy is quite low. Why is it so? Because we had only considered three fluids here. The system could have been vast with a larger number of components. So our dynamic system and the cold storage, each of them have their own pros and cons. The dynamic system has a higher efficiency if working in completely ideal conditions, without needing the infrastructure of a room or eutectics, etc., as it consumes very little power and optimizes the resources. However, the system needs to approximately be modeled for increasing its capacity and may incur high costs for maintaining the constant flow of the liquid, and hence needs a constant supply of electricity. On the other hand, if we talk about the cold storage room, optimizing the room to minimize the heat ingress helps in its efficient working for more than 24 hours, and it does not require refrigeration during that duration, which is a great achievement. And hence we can utilize it as a buffer in absence of electricity. It however needs high amount of power to recool the eutectic to its solid state. Hence, both the systems compared and ideated by us have their own pros and cons, and hence it depends upon the user, his budget, his requirements as to which system would be more efficient for him. Our work can be expanded upon by making the dynamic model fully robust by including pumping conditions, etc., as well, and by taking into account the various losses which happen at different places during the flow. Also, the flow could be remodeled in two ways as shown in this figure. It could either be a channel flow, that is water entering from one side and leaving from the other, or it could also be modeled as a recycled stream, because we observed that the temperature of the inlet stream does not change much reaching the outlet. So this can also be recycled to cool the subsequent layers of fluids, and its efficiency can be contemplated upon. Also, varying the velocity and taking it into the turbulent regime could also make the outlet temperature profile different and might cause different results. So we feel that the different analysis done by us for the benefit of product generation will be useful for the masses of the country if implemented in proper non-ideal conditions. We hope that you enjoyed our work and would appreciate the various ways in which simple heat transfer models can be of great help to people. Thank you so much.